Welcome to my Sunday farm. Today I have this box and I wanted to get through opening this. I just have a tiny mini haul. So let's see what's in here. Let's go ahead and open it. And I see I have some clothes. And I've been trying to get a winter wardrobe together. As far as having like something casual to wear around the house. And so like I ordered something for the show also. Maybe I'll show you that soon. But for now, I had originally thought these would be cute, but now I'm seeing that it's not the correct color for the show. So I mean, but I'm slowly getting a winter wardrobe together just by, you know. And these were for $5, you know, these are Hanes. You're not breaking the bank. I know a lot of you guys like to wear boots and sweatpants. These are cute. You see how it's pretty simple. Actually, these are kind of large. They say small, because that's what I ordered, small. But they say small and they kind of are big. When you wash them, I'm pretty sure they're gonna shrink, but they're still kind of big for me. But I don't know, I might try them, or maybe save them. Maybe Christmas is coming up, maybe that's what I'll do with them. I don't know, but they're kind of big for me. I guess I should try extra small on this. But they're only $5, so it's not even a big deal. Oh, and then I got this coffee I wanted to try. It's Gevalia. It's like from Sweden or something. This is Guatemalan coffee. So this is from Guatemala. And they have different places. Like they have like actually some of the best places that make coffee. And this one also says Rainforest Alliance. So like this is like, they're like known for making really quality coffee. And a lot of the sources that they get are from countries that do have quality coffee. And this is sweet and creamy. These are coffee creamers. And they're just little, they have shelf life. So that's really cool. They're just plain. They are sweetened, so that's cool. Yeah, it says sugar right there on second thing. So these are sweeteners, and you know they have cream qualities to it, so that's pretty cool. And then the last thing I wanted to show you guys was this to go with that. Was an actual mug that I got for like $3. And this is cute. I saw it online and I was like, oh, that is super cute. Isn't it cute? Well, that's my little coffee haul. Like part of it. And then let's see, put this there. And then I'm getting one more package that I ordered that day, so I'll be sure to show it to you guys because I'm really excited. So this is actually, muffin mix. This has chocolate chips in it, so it's chocolate chip muffin mix, and I also have cookie mix. So this is chocolate chip cookie mix. See, you just need butter and water. This one you need oil, eggs, and water. So it's pretty simple, and that's about it that I got today. But I wrote some notes down, I was journaling all weekend long and thinking of you guys, and I was thinking maybe I could read some of this off to you guys, because like I'm gonna be coming up with some more recipe videos and stuff, but and some more haul videos, so be sure to look out for those. But I just wanted to go over some of these things that I wrote down, and I wanted to show you my little journaling. See, like, it's not perfect, and a lot of times, like, when you cite things, you find holes in the stories, or sometimes it's a narrative that is kind of a little bit biased, or, you know, like, whatever your citations, you know, they should always have a neutral tone to them and just give the facts, period. But you see in this heightened political, you know, violation climate, there's so much going on because of the Biden admin influence. So they can't just give the news, they have to give their 2 cents and demands as well, orders and demands. And I wish I was joking, but that's like what I've been seeing a lot lately, instead of how they say making progress in the transfer of powers, peace. Like, I don't know why it's so hard for them. It's like pulling teeth. But I did read the UN had called for immediate cessation of Israeli arms embargo at a meeting. They had this meeting with a bunch of powerful people during the week. And I wanted to share that with you guys, and I wrote that down. So that was the first thing that I have written, because I knew that some of these other things that I had written down needed more thorough investigation. And I knew that I wouldn't be able to cover it all in one sit, you know, like one sitting of journaling. And you can see I filled in some of these holes, and then I began new ones, new paragraphs. I want to show you guys that it's easily fixable, because you just fill them in, and if you mess up again, you can continue with another story on the next page, and you can just keep, you know, correcting the story, adding on to stories as you find more information, and then continue on with the current stuff. And that's exactly what you see here. This is the current stuff, and so I'll get on with it. So as you've heard, they had that meeting at the UN where they had this letter that was circulated about an arms embargo. That was like probably the last of their demands to pull together and tie, you know, the countries together in unison for taking action against any thing deemed a threat to peace talks. So the arms embargo, of course, was read at that meeting, calling for the immediate cessation. Now, so that was, like I said, the first statement on my journal, and the second one is similar in political contrast. So Pakistan, second bombing Friday, was a suicide bomber. Last week, they had targeted our vulnerable, causing the stop to the vaccination of polio. They were administering at the time an explosive tied to a motorcycle was detonated on location, causing the vaccines and other aids led by the UN to at least pause. Now, the suicide bombing this weekend happened at a train station where 100 people were waiting to board at the time the attackers set the bomb off. 25 victims' lives were claimed and 50 were sent to hospital, and that death toll was expected to rise. So, like I said, this information is as of yesterday. Now, an armed group in Amsterdam, this is why it's important to document as you go along, because it's kind of like a story that unfolds, and as you learn more about it, it's like a natural rhythm to it. This is all news, so there's a natural rhythm to it, but also there's a like a tone to it, you know what I mean? Like, it's not unnatural. It's like kind of like as it unfolds in real time, you begin to kind of understand yourself and grasp at the facts behind it and kind of divulge into the uncomfortable truths that are happening now. So, like, if you're staying current and going on in your journaling with current events, you'll notice that. And I think it's a lot to, you know, when you're sharing these things, like, or if you end up publishing these things for others to read, it kind of becomes a good, solid, you know, interesting read. So an armed group in Amsterdam crept upon a group of Jewish people, consisting of women and children as well, violently stabbing and injuring them. These videos are circulating, causing much stir internationally. And as you see, all the holes are filled. I wrote when, where, the suspect's status. And as I went along learning about this, I filled it in. When? Israel versus Amsterdam, where outside a stadium during soccer games, the suspect status. And I found out that November 9th, one suspect was arrested. But today, I looked back and I said, why does this sound like none of this makes sense? Each media outlet has their own version of stories. I need facts. So of course, I kind of dug for facts, and in knowing, you know, stories behind, you know, the country's history of events that were foretold for sensationalism, I think that if you understood the backstory behind all of this, it's kind of sad. Because before they had all this influence of, you know, anti-immigration, you know, and choosing and picking which migrants can stay and all that. I think with the Biden admin pushing that into the forefront as a actual exploitative topic, you know, and it kind of made people decide impulsively where they stood on that. And of course, how easy is it to do the least by your neighbor? How easy is it, you know what I mean, to do life wrong or to do others wrong? How easy is that? Just ask the Biden admin, because they had a lot of influence throughout the world. So in saying that, Ajax of Amsterdam, they're in a historically Jewish neighborhood, their stadium in Amsterdam, Netherlands. And it was like they were proud of that neighborhood. They waved that in front of people. And when they held games there, they were very proud to show it off to the world. But as this politically violent climate, quote unquote, and I'm quoting Kamala Harris, would have it this year. This year it turned south. And for a lot of people, all those proud Jewish themes stopped. They had songs, they had like little things that they did because they were proud, but they stopped. They had to stop. People forced them to stop. And this was Maccabi Tel Aviv game versus Ajax Amsterdam soccer game. And like I said, it was during the soccer games, but it was outside that they were rioting. This caused several injuries. They reported at least 75 injuries. And like I said, November 9th, one suspect was arrested. But as I dug further, I found out that 65 were arrested immediately when some places said there were none arrested that night, especially. So you can find all the biases you want. Like I said, because of that influence, but the truth is out there. And as far as this part, there were people stabbed, there were people run over, there were people pulled out of cabs and lynched. There were three planes flew in by Israel to receive any civilians that were there for the games and send them back home safely. So, this really happened. Now this is Hurricane Raphael. I think this is still Saturday. Hurricane Raphael grew wildly, and as acting wildly as it was originally going to affect the Gulf of Mexico near Texas, Louisiana border, it's now expected to weaken as it travels in a U-turn back down to the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. When originally it was supposed to make landfall 12 a.m. as a tropical storm, Wednesday, Thursday, it would turn into a tropical depression as it was still inland. So this had a correction. Hurricane Rafael is slowly weakening. It's a tropical storm. It will downgrade to a tropical depression at midnight. So that's about it with Raphael because it's really, really slowing down, really, really weakening. But if it were to go down to Mexico, there's no telling where it would land. If it would be, it would probably be near the Yucatan. So that's kind of where that's at. Typhoon Nika, Taraji, aka Typhoon Nika, was forming a typhoon status Sunday, Monday at noon. It will make the landfall at Isabela. Heavy rain, storm weather to continue through the week. Now, Typhoon Taraji, aka Nika, forming was supposed to approach the Philippines today, and it also turned into a typhoon today as far as status. Now, Monday at noon, it should make landfall at Isabela as the heavy rains will continue throughout the week with storm weather possible even to through the late parts of the week. And you remember Typhoon Yingqing, aka Mars? It's near China's island Henan. It will turn south and head into the direction of Vietnam. So I'm not sure if it turned south yet, but it was supposed to go towards China's Hainan Island, and then just go down. So, I mean, these cyclones are pretty interesting. Now, Typhoon Moni is formed. It was supposed to go over some islands, but I didn't quite catch the details on that. Not much residential area has been noticed yet, but we're watching it. And Hurricane Rafael, I already read that one. That was the update. And then you can update on the areas that you haven't written on. Even if you like mess up this bad, like you have marks. So you just add in the spaces in between, and you can write little footnotes on the sides or wherever you have room or space. And nationally, we have been seeing fire warnings, tornado, and also thunderstorms as well. And this morning, I wanted to go over the weather, so I wrote down these notes, and it has changed a little bit, but not that much. It has changed, I think, in a way that maybe the thunderstorms were a little bit more severe. Ideal weather, let's say local weather, and it's not ideal because it's been raining. Local weather in Cincinnati, Ohio, we had early morning downpours expected to continue till tonight. Sunshine tomorrow, cloudy couple of days, rain Thursday with a cloudy weekend ahead next week, more rain to start after. So next weekend, I think it's going to be cloudy, and then it'll start raining again by Monday, right? But this week, we saw it rain. It started with the rain, but tomorrow it'll be cloudy, and it'll be cloudy for a couple days after. But Thursday, it will definitely rain, it says. And so that's the local weather in Cincinnati, Ohio, and it is part of the Midwest. So, and speaking of the Midwest, column of thunderstorm formed over Midwest from Louisiana-Texas border over and up into Michigan-Canada border. It's moving east. Parts of East Coast are already seeing storms as well. And I would like to add to that because, like I said, almost the entire Midwest is seeing storms as well. So, but there was a column that started at the Louisiana-Texas border and reached all the way from Michigan-Canada border, you know, and in between. And it was moving east, but part of the East Coast already was seeing storms. But now we're seeing that there's spots in between, you know, as well. So the whole Midwest is kind of lit up with thunderstorm warnings. Now, midpoint in open water between Cuba and Jamaica. This was recent. An earthquake shook at Richter scale of 6.8, bringing down rubble that was once part of buildings, leaving heaps of debris to further clean as tropical air looms. Jamaica reported aftershocks and a tsunami warning was issued. So, you know how Cuba has been having kind of all these problems. They had a blackout where they lost their electricity system. So they're right now dealing with having zero electricity. And for parts that are impacted by Hurricane Oscar and Hurricane Rafael, they're having to clean through the aftermath and recuperate. Now, today they saw a offshore earthquake. It shook Jamaica and Cuba and the surrounding areas with the 6.8 Richter scale. And Jamaica has reported aftershocks. And they were kind of frightened because it shook kind of hard. 6.8. So they immediately issued the tsunami warning, but they were noting that they didn't think that there was a tsunami threat, but they were issuing one because it was, you know, it was kind of severe. And so moving on, I think this is the last story I have. Yeah, this is, I think, the last story I have. And it's about Spain. And kind of like, also, it turned political. Because like, when we understand when our government kind of doesn't act, when in times of the, you know, the citizens' needs and calls for, you know, assistance, even in the aftermath of a natural disaster, you know, they don't act, react, and respond correctly. And we know that because we've been through that. But I think this kind of blindsided them because they have a lot of pride in their country. And, you know, who would expect that your own officials would, you know what I mean? Like, they would kind of kick back on your duress or times, like I said, of need. But as we know, that does happen. And then they demand for office again, to hold office again, in the most lowest ways. But that's the thing here. See, I wrote down this. Demonstrators calling for officials to be fired after the Dana and monsoon destruction. Some asking not just for Spain's PM to be dismissed, but also, I think it's Mason, the mayor of Valencia, seat to be opened as well. So, you know, they demonstrated in Spain demanding the removal of the mayor of Valencia. They, you know, showed up with just as much might as they did to help clean up and recover and help their neighbors get, you know, some water, some food, some clothes, some dog food. You know, as much as they went to bat for their neighbor, they came, you know, for their country as well, for the dignity, you know, that's left of the people. Now, this outpouring of voices was quickly and swiftly deterred by a large police presence, who met the protest group with significant strength, causing the crowd to grow frustrated, and thus many in the group began to push back. Coverage of the event is being seen worldwide, opening one's deafened ears to concerned people who probably thought the disaster was just a marvel of nature. And this is a lot of times true when the world hears, you know, your agony. They don't understand the background. They don't understand if there's a backstory or the facts behind your situation. They just know, you know, what's being said by the media outlets, what they're reading, you know, what's being documented by people. You know, that's why journaling is so important, because I mean, it's so interesting. Around the world, so many different situations arise, and they're met, you know, with such, you know, I'd say responsive, you know, responsiveness. I think a lot of times that you don't expect to hear the story just that soon, just completely be exposed. And I'd say, you know what I mean? Like, they have this inner strength that you can kind of admire. to just put away the ego and say, you know what? We can pull this country together. We have endured from here. We can, you know, set aside everything that's ever gone on and start anew. And it sounds so familiar. And yet it's on another, you know, it's in another country. But also we are all human and we all go through things. Whether it's by nature, indifference, or, you know, neutrality and bipartisanship. But, you know, one thing's for sure, we can learn and grow from each other and support each other as well. And, you know, at the end of the day, I think we really do need each other. In more Dana news, a radar scan will be conducted by sea to search for those missing. While the death toll still tops 200 people impacted have a lot to recover from still. So they're sending a boat or a ship or something with the radar to scan the seabeds. And they're gonna search for missing people. And as that continues to happen, you know, the people impacted in those zones are still recovering. So, you know, the people missing are from those zones. So there's a lot, you know, to be said by these people, you know, as their stories are told. And I think that's what's important about, you know, having a journal that does include current events or not. You know, it could just be something about you. And even if you get stuck in certain parts in time, you will learn more, and not just your experiences, but being exposed to it continuously will change your story, and it could, you know, affect kind of where your strengths lie. As far as the storyline. And I think that's important to learn when you're journaling. What's the main takeaway? Because, you know, they're not just, in your journaling, it's not just gonna be like, always, you know what I mean, it's not just gonna be walks in the parks and, you know what I'm saying, fishing trips. So I don't know, what do you guys think? If you like this video, give it a like, and don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe. I really do hope you like this video. So I'll see you again on the next one. My son, Defrump. Bye-bye.